John Gill, 1 John chapter 2, verse 2. Scripture quote, "And he is the propitiation for our sins," unquote. "For the sins of us who now believe and are Jews." Scripture quote, "And not for ours only," unquote, "but for the sins of the Old Testament saints and of those who shall afterwards believe in Christ, and of the Gentiles also, signified in the next clause." Scripture quote, "But also for the sins of the whole world," unquote. The Syriac version renders it, "not for us only, but also for the whole world." That is, not for the Jews only, for John was a Jew, and so were those he wrote unto, but for the Gentiles also. Nothing is more common in Jewish writing than to call the Gentiles the world, and the whole world, the nations of the world. See Gill on John chapter 12, verse 19. And the word world is so used in Scripture. See John 3:16. And stands opposed to a notion the Jews have the Gentiles, that there is no propitiation for them. And it's easy to observe that when this phrase is not used of the Gentiles, it is to be understood in a limited and restrained sense, as when they say, "It happened to a certain high priest, that when he went out of the sanctuary, the whole world went after him," which could only design the people in the temple. But in elsewhere it is said, "The whole world has left the Mishnah and gone after the Gemara," that's G-E-M-A-R-A, "which at most can only intend the Jews, and indeed only a majority of their doctors who were conversant with these writings, and in another place, the whole world fell on their faces, but wrath," that's R-A-F, "did not fall on his face," where it means no more than the congregation. Once more, it is said, "When the whole world stood up before him," that is, the people in the synagogue, to which may be added, "When a great man makes a mourning, the whole world comes to honor him." An example, a great number of persons attend the funeral pomp, and so these phrases, "the whole world," is not divided or does not dissent. "The whole world are of opinion," are frequently met with in the Talmud, by which an agreement among the rabbins in certain points is designed, yea, the inhabitants of a city where a synagogue was, and at most only the Jews. And so this phrase, "all the world," or "the whole world," and scriptures, unless when it signifies the whole universe or the habitable earth, is always used in a limited sense, either for the Roman Emperor or the churches of Christ in the world, or believers, or the present inhabitants of the world, or a part of them only. See Luke chapter 2, verse 1. And so it is in this epistle, 1 John chapter 5, verse 19, where the whole world lying in wickedness is manifestly distinguished from the saints who are of God and belong not to the world, and therefore cannot be understood of all the inhabitants in the world. And the like distinction is in this text itself, for the sins of the whole world are opposed to our sins. The sins of the apostle and others to whom he joins himself, who therefore belonged not to nor were a part of the whole world, for whose sins Christ is a propitiation as for theirs, so that this passage cannot furnish out any argument for universal redemption. For besides these things, it may be further observed that for whose sins Christ is a propitiation, their sins are atoned for and pardoned, and their person is justified from all sin, and so shall certainly be glorified, which is not true of the whole world, and every man and woman in it. Moreover, Christ is a propitiation through faith in his blood. The benefit of his propitiatory sacrifice is only received and enjoyed through faith, so that in the event it appears that Christ is a propitiation only for believers, a character which does not agree with all mankind. Add to this that for whom Christ is a propitiation, he is also an advocate. 1 John chapter 2, verse 1. But he is not an advocate for every individual person in the world. Yea, there is a world he will not pray for. John 17, verse 9. The consequently is not a propitiation for them. Once more, the design of the apostle in these words is to comfort his little children with the advocacy and propitiatory sacrifice of Christ, who might fall into sin through weakness and inadvertence. But with comfort would it yield to a distressed mind to be told that Christ was a propitiation not only for the sins of the apostles and other saints, but for the sins of every individual in the world, even of these that are in hell? Would it not be natural for persons in such circumstances to argue rather against than for themselves and conclude that seeing persons might be damned notwithstanding the propitiation sacrifice of Christ, that this might and would be their case? In what sense Christ is a propitiation? See Gill on Romans 3:25. The Jews have no notion of the Messiah as a propitiation or atonement. Sometimes they say, repentance atones for all sin. Sometimes the death of the righteous. Sometimes incense. Sometimes the priest's garments. Sometimes it is a duty of atonement. And indeed, they are in the utmost puzzle about atonement, and they even confess in their prayers that they have now neither altar nor priest to atone for them. See John on 1 John chapter 4, verse 10.